Week, and we'll see how far we get tonight. We ended up in a place, very interesting text that I think is good for us just to be reminded of, especially as we move forward as Christians. It goes along with the sermon from Sunday about being kind one to another. We are called upon to be different, to be difference makers in this world. We're not just to fit in. We're to make a difference. And we make a difference by being different. That's how we make a difference. And that means, it means many times, it means going the extra mile. When we talk about Sunday kindness, here we talk about consolation. Paul says, he talks about going through trials and tribulations and persecutions, but he said it was important for him to go through those because then God could comfort him. And then as he received that comfort from God and he allowed that comfort to change him to be more like Christ, then he gave that out to whoever needed it. And so it was a matter of passing it on. I've told you before, many times what we do is we want God to give us everything. But then we never give anything back, or we never pass it on. You see, the Christian should be, this is the way it should be. We should be, Lord, I have a need. And God gives us the need, and we take it, and we give it out. And we come back and say, Lord, I have another need. And God gives it to us, and we give it out. But the majority of Christians, what they do is they say, Lord, I have a need. And God provides it, and they stuff it in their pockets. And they, God, I think I still have a need. And they get it. They keep stuff in their pockets. Before long, they're all blowed up. They don't have any place to put any more God's blessings because they've taken them and they've used them up. Listen, we need to be giving them out. God blesses you. Bless somebody with it. The same thing with suffering. If you go through a time of suffering and God comforts you, look for the opportunity to share that comfort with somebody else. Paul was specific. He said, I go through this persecution. I go through these trials because God wants you to receive the comfort that he gives me. That's exactly what he said. Let's look at verse 6. Whether we be afflicted, it is for your consolation, he says, and salvation, which is effectual in the enduring of the same suffering, which we also suffer, or whether we be comforted, it is for you. It is for your consolation and salvation, he says. That's the reason that... I think, like I said, this is the way I ended last week. What a great way to look at suffering and persecution and problems and trials. You see, most of us, we look at them like, oh, no, poor me. I don't know how I'm going to make it. I don't know what I'm going to do. Help me. Oh, I need help. I don't know what I'm going to do. Paul says, man, look at this. We're going to go through this, and God's going to come, and he's going to give us what we need, and we'll be able to give it to somebody else. What a great way to look at problems. Amen. We're so self-centered. Amen? And we may not like to say that, but we are. We're selfish. I'm concerned about me. I'm concerned about my mind. I mean, that's it. I make sure I'm taken care of. Now, if I'm taken care of, I may help somebody. Right? You know, if God is blessing you, if God is taking care of you, if God's provided for you, you need to look for the opportunity to give it away. Give it to somebody. Share it with somebody. Now, it can be money, it can be financial, but I'm thinking more along the lines of what Paul's about here, this consolation. You know what consolation is? Consoling. How can you console somebody if you don't make connection with them? Can you do that? You can't. I really think the word for us this year is connection. I really think we need to get connected. We need to get concerned about each other as a church, as a body, as a family, but then outside. When somebody has a hurt or a need, we need to look for the opportunities to help and jump in the middle of it and console. That's what it's all about. You can't. Don't tell me you're consoling people if you're not in their business, if you're not helping them, if you're not a part of their life, if you're not looking at them. It's eyeball to eyeball thing, you know? We've got to do that. So this is what Paul leads, and that's where I want to start tonight. Verse 7, and our hope of you is steadfast, he says. Our hope for you in receiving the comfort that we have, in receiving the consolation, our hope is for you is steadfast, unwavering, knowing that as you are partakers, as you receive of the suffering, so shall you be also of the consolation. So Paul says, we do this, and hopefully, we hope that you catch the vision and you take it to the next level too. This isn't just for the preachers or the deacons or Sunday school. This is for everybody. I don't know who you are. You're sitting here tonight. This is for you. Well, I'm not even a member of the church. Doesn't matter. You're a Christian, aren't you? If you're a Christian, this is for you. This is something we all need to be involved in. Verse 8. For we would not, brethren, have you ignorant of our trouble, which came to us in Asia, that we were pressed out of measure, above strength, insomuch that we despaired even of life. Wow. You know what my first question was? Why did Paul feel like he needed to share that? Why does Paul need to share that? I mean, the fact, and I'm not sure what particular instance he's talking about. I have a feeling it may be when he was stoned and left for dead at Lystra. Remember, that was a pretty bad thing going on there. And persecuted to the point where he would run out of town. That could have been it. It may be something we don't even know about, but he says it was bad. This persecution was bad, pressed beyond measure. Now, I've been through some persecution before, but I've never been pressed beyond measure. You know, I get up the next morning and go on. Paul says this was bad. He said it was so bad, he said it's above strength. It robbed him of his strength. It literally, and if you think back to Lystra, and they stoned him and left him for dead. I mean, literally, he had no strength. It was his disciples or his men that were with him that took him, picked him up, and carried him to Derby so he could recoup. I mean, he was without strength. He had been persecuted to the point of death and may have even died. We think he possibly could have died and been, God said, you're not coming home yet. Get back down there, you know. But he could have dead. In fact, he said, in so much that we despaired even of life. Like, we're not going to live through this. This is bad. It's as bad as it gets. This is bad. Are y'all with me?
Yes.
Y'all are really quiet. It's bad. Thank you. It's bad. Y'all say bad.
Bad.
That's right. Bad. Bad. Really bad. It's bad, bad. It's bad as it gets. Bad. It's bad. Well, he said it's bad. But look, but we had the sentence of death in ourselves. Paul. Why would God, you're a servant of God. You are the premier apostle of the New Testament. You wrote 13 of the New. Why would God allow you to go through that kind of persecution? What is wrong with your God? Paul says, whoa, wait a minute. Finish the statement. That we should not trust in ourselves, but in God which raiseth from the dead. I just love that. Paul, yeah, thank you. Paul is looking at the most desperate time of persecution in his life, and he said, you know what? It taught me to trust in God. That was good to Paul. And not only that, he said to trust in the fact in a God which raises from the dead. If God chooses to kill me, it's okay. He can raise me from the dead if he wants to. Why am I worried about it? I love Sharon came to visit me today. We were talking, and we've said this. I've talked to Jeff different ones about, you know, and I think I said this in the service the other day. You know, when you've got a God that has the ability to do that, what in the world are you wiping, are you running around with your lower lip dragging the ground, complaining about your Christianity and so on? How in the world can you do that when you've got a God that will put you through something so you can learn to trust Him and also train you or teach you that there's nothing so bad that He can't fix, even death? That's awesome, isn't it? Woo! I like that. It just makes sense. Paul says, I look at it and I can see exactly what God was doing. Well, if I had been in that situation, I might have had a harder time looking at it like that, wouldn't you? Are you honest with me?
Yeah.
And I'll tell you something else. Why would Paul present to these people this idea that things were so bad? You know why? I'll tell you why. Because when we're open to share with one another like that, who benefits? Everybody that hears. Paul's giving some instruction here like nothing you've you just don't, this is what it's all about. Have you ever thought that in suffering is the greatest tool of God to bring you to a deeper faith? Have you ever thought about that? There's no greater tool that he uses to teach you to trust him than trouble. Trouble with a capital T rhymes with P. You want to call it poop? Anyway. You know what? There's people in here who do not know what I just talked about. Never seen The Music Man. Oh my goodness. I haven't seen that one either. Oh, but listen. No matter how big, in fact, listen to what Paul says. I love this. Who delivered us from so great a death, and doth deliver, in whom we trust that he will yet deliver us. He said, even in the areas that he hadn't delivered us yet, it's okay, because he's going to. It's going to happen. He's not through. That's his job. That's what he loves to do. He loves to deliver us. Now, when we think about delivering, sometimes we have the bad idea. We've got it in our heads what that looks like. You see, God's deliverance and our deliverance may be a different thing altogether. Amen? I've told the story, Ken Stewart, when I first came to church, Brother Ken Stewart, he came to me one time and he said, Brother, I want you to come visit with me. I said, okay. So I went by his house. It was a Tuesday. And he said, I want you to come every Tuesday and pray with me. I said, well, okay, what's going on? He said, I have ALS. I have ALS. I'm only going to live about a year. You'll be preaching my funeral in a year unless God does something. And I will never forget the last Sunday that he was here. He came down the aisle. He said, I need you to pray for me. Pray for healing. I said, okay. But you know that my healing is, I'm going to pray selfishly because I want God to physically heal you, but God may heal you another way. He said, I know, I'm ready. Whatever God wants. And God healed him completely. Better than any kind of healing I was praying for. And Brother Ken got to go home and be with the Lord. Sometimes our deliverance that we want from God, we put God in a box. I want you to deliver me, God, and I know exactly what it's going to look like. And God just kind of grins and says, you ain't got an idea, buddy. You ain't got an idea. And Paul says, he will deliver you. Let's go on. I've got a note in here, and I sure don't want to get past it. Watch this. Verse 11. Ye also helping together by prayer for us. So God's delivering, but look what Paul does. Paul tells this church, you know what? You have been helping us through this deliverance, through these persecutions. How, Paul? By praying for us. You know, prayer's a tool that we do not use enough as Christians. It's usually the last thing we consider, and it should be the first, you know? Well, I didn't know what else to do, so I prayed to the Lord. You know, you should have started there, amen? You'd have been a lot better off if you just started there. But he said, you prayed for us, that for the gift bestowed upon us by the means of many persons, thanks may be given by many on our behalf. Did you hear what he said? The gifts. The gift. What gift did they bestow on him? Well, we could talk about a lot of them. He said he's bestowed by others, benefits. Others. It could be a material gift. They could have materially given him something. It could have been like an honorarium. Or it could be a gift of service, you know, to him. It could have been knowing Paul. It could be the gift of ministry. But can I tell you what I think it is? I think we read it. It's the gift of prayer. It's the gift of prayer. Never underestimate the gift of prayer. If somebody says, I'll pray for you, and they do, you couldn't ask for a better gift than that. It doesn't matter what your need is. If they will pray for you, you've been given a great gift. Don't, my word is, don't poop it off. Amen. Understand, this is a great gift, prayer. Effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Prayer. I dare say all of us need a series on prayer, don't we? None of us probably pray as we should. When I read about the great men of old, man, they were on the... remember the story I gave you about the young men were visiting Wesley's home, and the man took the young men up to the second floor, and there beside his bed was a carpet, and there it was indented where his knees were, where he prayed. Man of God, no wonder God used him. He prayed all the time. He was a prayer warrior. One of those great men wrote this. Listen to this. Oh, and I want you to get it. In prayer, human impotence casts itself at the feet of divine omnipotence. I'm going to say it again because that is a great statement. In prayer, human impotence, our inabilities, are cast at the feet of the divine omnipotence. That's God. I come saying, God, I can't do it. I don't know what I'm going to do. And God says, I can do it. There's nothing that I can't do. That's what prayer is all about. But so many times we fail to understand and miss the opportunities just to pray. Just to come alongside God and what He's doing and pray for those who are in need. How many times when somebody comes and said, man, I'm hurting, I need some prayer, and they don't mean for me to pray right then. Grady taught me this, and I think it's a great tool. He said, these guys out at the unit, he'd come up and say, man, Grady, will you pray for me? And Grady said, sure, let's pray right now. And he just bowed his head, and them guys go, oh, okay, you know, we're going to pray. Do it right then. And how many times it blesses that person. They walk away, just, you can tell God got hold of them. And God was there, and we used it. We understood, because when they say, will you pray for me, and you do it right then, you've showed how important it is to you. Because you do it right then. If you put it off, you're kind of saying, yeah, I'll pray for you when I get around to it. I'll pray for you on Wednesday night. Let me put you on the prayer list. I'll pray for you Wednesday night. Well, you're saying, well, it's, you know, sometime or another I'll get around to pray. Why not right then? Right there. Why don't we just pray for people? I told you, Ruby and I, we eat out. Most of the times, many times, the waiter or waitress, they'll come and they'll start to bring our food. And it's before we prayed for the food. And I'll just say, you know, we're going to pray for our food. Can we pray for you? Well, yeah. Well, we're going to pray right now. And sometimes they stop and they stand there while you pray. What a great opportunity to pray for people. You know, no matter where you're at, we can pray. Amen?
Amen.
You say, I don't know how to pray. You know how to talk? You know how to pray. Don't use that excuse ever again. It won't work. Doesn't work. If you can't pray, then quit talking. That's all I can tell you. Because prayer is just talking to God. That's all it is. That's all it is. Well, I don't have all the these and thous. I haven't heard many of us pray like that, have you? You know? Pray with Jeff. Daddy, daddy! Who's he talking to? He's talking to his daddy. That's who he's talking to. Pray with Hayward. Master. You know, it's a reality of our relationship when we can pray like we're talking to our Father. Pray. It's a gift, and we need to pray. All right, let's go on. He said, the gift put on us. Thanks for giving me. Verse 12. For our rejoicing is this. What, Paul? The testimony of our conscience, that in simplicity and godly sincerity, not with fleshly wisdom, but by the grace of God, we have had our conversation in the world and more abundantly to you word. You know what he's talking about? He's talking about prayer ministry. He's talking about ministry. He's talking about a person who realizes he has been used by God to minister to others' needs, finds a joyful spirit inside. Not boastful, not because you're something, because God used. It is because you realize, like he said, in simplicity and godly sincerity, you were the testimony. God used you to be the testimony, the witness to those around you. That's what it's all about. Not with fleshly wisdom. People say, I just can't talk to people about the Lord. I just don't know what to say. Well, that's because you keep trying to figure it out that it's all about what you know. But see, salvation is not about what you know. Salvation is about what God knows about you and what he knows about that person. And all you need to do is just give them a little step up, a little help to start the process where they can hear what God has to say about them and what their needs are. We turned it into a mechanical thing where you got to have all the right verses. You got to have all the... You know, you don't. You know John 3:16? If you don't know it, you know where it's found. All you have to do is just take your Bible out and read it to them. That's all. That's the gospel. We don't have to have a bunch of... We don't have to have a degree in soteriology to be able to lead somebody to Christ. All we need to do is just tell them what happened to us. Just open the door. That's exactly right. I can't tell you how many times I've said, I was 9 years old. A man shared me what the Bible says in John 3:16, and I quote the verse. And I said, he told me that that's what I needed, was to be saved at 9 years old. I bowed my head and asked Jesus to come in my heart. Would you like to do that? That's salvation right there, period. That's all you have to do. It's not hard. Simplicity. We make Christianity hard. It's not hard. It's simplicity. And it's with godly sincerity. I love that. It's sincere. We talked about humility last week. Here is sincerity. We've got to be real about what we feel. We've got to be real about why we feel the way we do. If it's a matter you're trying to make it up, well, it's probably going to come across that way. But when it's real to you, they know. They feel it. I remember I was talking to my granddaughter and was sharing the gospel with her. And I so wanted her to be saved. I couldn't hardly finish the gospel story with her because I wanted so bad to reach out and just grab hold of her and say, come on, let's pray, you know. Let's do it right now. You just have a sincerity. There's something that you just want so bad. That's what Paul's talking about here. Not with fleshly wisdom, but by the grace of God. God has to do it all. We have had our conversation, our conduct in the world, Paul says. That's the way Paul lived. Why was Paul such a great Christian? I'll tell you why. Because he trusted God for everything. He knew that he couldn't do anything except what God did through him. And the more he yielded himself to God, the more God used him. And that's why we look at him and say he's one of the greatest Christians that lived in the New Testament. And it's not because of anything he did. It's because of what God did through him. It was just him letting God do things through him. That's all. That's what he said right there. But by the grace of God, we've had our conversation in the world. And more abundantly to youward, the Corinthians, those who participated in their lives by praying with them. He said, we've interacted with each other. We've seen God do great things. Verse 13, for we write none other thing unto you. He says, I'm not hiding anything from you. I'm not making anything up to try to get anything out of you than what you read or acknowledge. What you've read or understood, and I trust you shall acknowledge or understand even to the end. Paul knew the days were going to get worse. It was going to get tougher. Things weren't going to go smooth. He knew Jerusalem was in his sights. He knew when he got there, things were going to get tough, and it was going to get bad, and it was going to get worse than anything he's ever had before. And he knew that it was coming, and they were going to send it. He didn't know for sure, but they sent him off to prison, where he finally dies. But it was coming. Paul says, look, we're going to get through this to the end. Even to the end, he says. Verse 14, as also you have acknowledged, you've understood us in part, that we are your rejoicing, even as you also are ours in the day of the Lord Jesus. Rejoice over the work God allows your pastor and leaders to do, because you know why? If you're praying for them, you have a part. That's what he said. You have a part. We are your rejoicing, even as you also are ours in the day of the Lord. I'm sorry, before that. As also you have acknowledged us in part. You've been a part of what we're doing. They weren't with Paul at Lystra. They weren't there to defend him as he was getting beaten. But Paul said, because you were praying for us, because you were a part of it. You're a part of it. Every time a person gets saved here, you're a part of it. You say, well, I didn't have anything to do with it. Yes, you did. You were part of this church. You're part of it. You're part of the work. You're part of the ministry. Everything, you pray for your pastor, you pray for me. God gives me the opportunity to witness or to preach or to share, to do so. Listen, whatever the results are, you have a part in that. Because you prayed, you were a part of it. You gave that gift of prayer. Man, don't ever forget that. I don't forget it. Because I can do nothing without God. And I sure need your prayers for everything that God did. This week is one of those weeks. I'm counting on your prayers this week. It got loaded up. And I've got such a great opportunity. You know, funerals are one of the greatest opportunities for a witness for Christ of anything I do. Do you realize that? There's people that come to funerals, don't go to church. And I can tell you this, your preacher will give them the gospel every time. I never fail. Because it may be the only shot they get. And I want to make sure they hear the gospel. So tomorrow and Saturday, I'll be giving the gospel out on two different occasions. And you'll be praying. And if somebody gets saved, if somebody hears the gospel and gets saved, you had a part in that. That's what Paul's saying here. You have a part. And then he says, you also are ours, even as you also are ours in the day of the Lord Jesus. You know, 3 John 4 says, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. Paul's saying about them, you bring me joy. When I hear what you do, how you pray for us, when I hear how you are a part of everything, he said, you bring me joy. That's what it's all about. Verse 15. And in this confidence, I was minded to come unto you before, that you might have a second benefit. I love this. This is kind of cool. This is a Pauline thing. This is Paul at his best, I think. Paul is being criticized by the false apostles everywhere he goes. Whatever he does, it doesn't matter what he does, they pick on him, you know. And even his scheduling, you know. You know, well, he didn't come to see you, and he went right by you. You know, you didn't see what kind of apostle he is. Paul here tells them, he said, let me tell you about my scheduling. And just watch this. He said, that you might have a second benefit. What do you mean by that, Paul? And to pass by you into Macedonia. So he said, when I go to Macedonia, I wanted to pass by and see you then. But he said, and then to come again unto Macedonia unto you, and of you to be brought on my way towards Judea. So the second benefit, he said, two times. I don't want to just see you once, I want to see you twice. I'm going to come once, and then I'm going to come back, and I'm going to be there again. I want you to understand how important it is that I see you, and that we're a part of each other. I want you to understand how much I consider this important. In fact, he says, verse 17, when I therefore was thus minded, did I use lightness? Was I lighthearted about this? When I made my decision about where I was going and the schedule I was keeping, did I just do that out of the thin blue air, or did I do it with some kind of conscious desire? Well, he's telling him, I did it on the purpose. I purposely did what I did. It wasn't just lightness. It wasn't insincere. Are the things that I purpose, do I purpose according to the flesh? Is it because it's easy for me that I make these decisions? That with me there should be yea, yea, and nay, nay. Now, again, this is kind of a funny way of putting it, Paul. What he's saying, he says, I don't want you to think that, you know, I'll say yes one time and no another time. I don't want you to think I'm that kind of person. You know, I say yay when it feels good that way, or no when it feels good that way. He said, I'm not that kind of person. I want my yea to be yea and my nay to be nay. He's going to get to that. But here he said, with me there should be yea, yea, nay, nay. That's the question, verse 18. But as God is true, our word towards you was not yea and nay. It wasn't yes and no. It wasn't give and take. It wasn't I'll do this and then do something else. Verse 19. For the Son of God, Jesus Christ, who was preached among you by us, even by me and Silvanus, that's Silas, and Timotheus, that's Timothy, was not yea and nay. It wasn't indecisive. It wasn't just what you wanted to hear. It was yea. Well, in fact, let's keep reading. But in him was yea. Yes. It was not wavering. It wasn't back and forth. It wasn't trying to please you. It wasn't just people pleasing, ear tickling. He said, I'm not that kind of person. I'm going to say yay to one person, nay to the other person. If I say yay, I'm going to say yay. I'm going to stick to it. I'm not going to be wavering back and forth. Verse 20, for all the promises of God in him, Jesus, are yea. And in him, amen.
oh my goodness, he must be Baptist.
In him are amen, or we agree, under the glory of God by us. You got to appreciate the Apostle Paul for this statement. This is what people look for in a preacher. Don't be wishy-washy. Don't be somebody that speaks out of both sides of your mouth. Let your yea be yea, let your nay be nay. That's what the Bible says. And that's the way preachers are to be, and that's what Paul says. He said, you know, if you know me, my yea is a yea and my nay is a nay. I don't falter between the two. I let God get the glory. It's a yea and an amen. That's why we say amen. Y'all know that's why you say amen, don't you? Amen is I agree. Amen. I'm agreeing with you, preacher. It's good. I like that. Amen. I like these girly amens, but I like manly amens too. There you go. Amen. Amen. Thank you. That's good. No. Amen. We agree. There's nothing wrong with that, is there? We ought to. You know, it really says something to those around us when we make those statements. I agree with you. It helps them. They're making a statement of truth. They're standing on the truth of God's word, and they're being attacked by it. Isn't it great to have somebody come along and say, hey, I'm with you. I'll stand with you. I'm here with you. It builds your confidence up. You get kind of bold, you know, when you get like that. Well, let's go to 21. We're going to finish this up. Now he which establisheth us with you in Christ and hath anointed us in God, who hath also sealed us and given the earnest of the Spirit in our hearts. So as he says that this amen unto the glory of God, he mentions four things, four ways that we are bound together. The first one, we're bound together. We are established in Christ. Our salvation binds us together. You didn't get saved any different than I did. Everybody here, if you're saved, you got saved the same way I got saved. In fact, you got saved the same way as somebody next to you. It may have been in a different setting, but it was the same way. You had to receive Jesus Christ. You had to recognize you're a sinner, and you had to receive Jesus Christ. If you didn't do one of those 2 days, you didn't get saved, so, you know, you need to get saved. But if you got saved, we all got saved the same way. Paul says, we were established together. So we have a unity. We have that oneness because we are established together in Christ. And then he says, and hath anointed us. God has anointed us. This is God who does that. The anointing. We've been commissioned for service. Christ gives us the Spirit who guides, empowers, teaches all believers. We are anointed. Anointed by what? By the Holy Spirit. Anointed by the Holy Spirit of God. If you're going to do something, God's going to use you in some way, you're going to be anointed by God. You're going to be anointed just as I'm anointed or anybody else is anointed. Same anointing, same one. There's no difference in the anointing, by the way. You may have some that want to tell you there is, there's not. Anointing is anointing. It's the anointing of the Holy Spirit. It's Him putting upon you the opportunities to do the things that God wants you to do. That's the anointing. It's not some thing you can go around and go, woo, I'm anointed, watch me, I'm anointed. No, if you're anointed, you're busy. Because God's anointed you to do something. He's anointed you for a process, something that He wants to accomplish. We've got a lot of them going around and we'll tell them about how anointed they are, and they're not doing anything. I don't know where the anointing comes from, but the Holy Spirit doesn't anoint you like that. Then thirdly, he says, who has also sealed us. You know, he keeps talking about the Holy Spirit because the Holy Spirit's the one that seals us, isn't he? The Holy Spirit seals us. We're sealed. Your salvation is sealed the same as mine's sealed by the Holy Spirit of God. If you think you're sealed by your good works, then you've got the wrong salvation. Your salvation is sealed by the Holy Spirit of God. God's the one that seals you. And then he says, not only that, he says, and given the earnest of the Spirit in our hearts. This is that he's given the earnest, the down payment of the Holy Spirit in our heart, Ephesians talks about. It's like a down payment, the earnest money. You have the Holy Spirit living in you. That's the earnest. God says, here, you're going to go to heaven someday. I'm going to give you the Holy Spirit. He's going to be the earnest. This is the surety that you're going to heaven when you die, because you have the Holy Spirit living in you. Pretty sure about that one. That's awesome. Verse 23, moreover, I call God for a record upon my soul. God is my witness, he's saying, that to spare you, I came not as yet unto Corinth. Not for that we have dominion over your faith, but are helpers of your joy. For by faith you stand. Oh my goodness. Let's see if I can share this. He says, I bear record. God is my witness that he gave them time to correct all that they had problems with. In the first book, in the first letter where he attacked them and really nailed them to the... He said, I didn't come right away back, because he said, I want to give you time to get things right. Basically what he's saying. I want you to, you need some time with God. I was talking with a young lady today. She's helping a young lady try to get back to her walk with God. And the little gal's reluctant. She's a little bit standoffish. She's trying to balk, you know. She's one of those that, well, I want to live for Jesus. Okay, well, here's what we need to do. Well, no. I don't think I want to go all that far. I don't think. And so this young lady's trying to work with her, and she wrote me a note, and she said, I've just kind of gone as far as I feel like I can. And I told her, I said, sometimes God works in silence if we'll just give him a chance. Just be quiet for a little bit, because God's working on them. And I think Paul understood that. Paul could have gone back and got on his soapbox and preached hellfire and damnation all over them again, and they could have made them mad and they would have left. But he recognized, you know, I'm not the Holy Spirit. I'm not the one that changes them. Did you see that? He said, not for that we have dominion over your faith. He said, I'm not in charge of your faith. I, as your pastor, I'm not in charge of your faith. You know that? I don't have it. You've got to make that decision. You've got to decide you want to grow in Christ. I'll give you all the tools. That's what Paul said. He said, I'm not dominion over your faith, but are helpers of your joy. For by faith you stand. That's the way I look at my job. I wish, you know, Sharon and I was talking about this today too. There were times when I know people, if they would just take that next step of faith, it would throw them into another area of Christian growth like they've never been in before. But until they're ready to go there, they're not going to go. You can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. You can lead Christians up to the Word of God, but you can't make them take it and live it. It's got to be their decision. And it is disappointing. As a pastor, it's disappointing, because you see in people's lives they could have great marriages if they would just yield in this one area of their lives. They could really be a service to the church if they would just give up in this one area that they have that keeps them from being used of God. And you see it and you wish you could just kind of give them a shake and say, hey, would you stop that? But it doesn't work that way. It's what Paul says. I'm not in charge of your faith. I don't have dominion over your faith. I can't make you do anything. I can encourage you. I can give you the principles to live by. I can try to be an example. Try to encourage you, but it's your decision. You realize that? Amen? I need everybody to say amen today.
Amen.
It's your decision. I can't do it. I can't do it for you. You've got to do it. If you made a decision to read the Bible every day this year, that's your decision. I can't make you. I can't make you. That's your decision. If you do it for 3 days, then you did it for 3 days. Oh, I wish you'd do it for 365. I know the blessing that comes when you do it for 365. But if you gave it for three, at least you got that far. There's just so many things that we could do. Well, okay, so Paul says, but are helpers of your joy, for by faith you stand. That's where it all comes back to, our faith. Amen? All right. Any question, comment, or thought as we finish up that chapter? Anybody?
Comment.
When
he's talking about the seal, think about the time they're in. There's a glob of wax and a big naughty ring on it. But Paul's talking about an eternal, unbreakable, living seal that can never be broken.
Nope.
And
it's God Himself.
That's right.
that seals it.
Right.
You know, he seals it, and nobody can break that seal. He's God. He's omnipotent. He's all powerful. I guess I'm through. Where did this thing come from? We're going to get rid of it. All right. Well, let's stand and be dismissed with a word of prayer. Oh, I'm sorry. Carolee? Okay, 4 spots left for Contagious Joy. If you're interested, make sure you get signed up. Let's stand and be dismissed with a word of prayer. Saturday at 5 o'clock, the winter celebration for all of our Sunday schools, and you're welcome to come. There is no children's thing provided. This is for our adult Sunday schools. And if you'd like to come, be here, 5 o'clock Saturday. All right? The funeral tomorrow is at 2:30. The funeral Friday is at 10 o'clock. Okay? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you again for this day. We thank you, God, like Paul said, Lord, for the troubles, for the times of trial that we go through. Lord, thank you for them. For it builds patience in us. It makes us, Father, like Paul said, to see the value of our relationship with you. And that we have a God that's able to do abundantly above all that we could ever think or ask. And then, Lord, may we share that consolation with those around us. May we bring them joy that Paul talks about as we share with them the wonder and awe of a God that's in control of everything in our lives. I pray, Father, you bless now this evening. Watch over us. Give us wisdom in decisions we need to make. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.